Hugh Hewitt inside the Beltway, where it's raining, desultory week ahead. People are really not in the Christmas mood because there isn't going to be much Christmas at all. Yesterday's Mass, I went to the least attended Mass. I'm being very, very cautious about this. The pastor preached a sermon about how maybe we'll really have Advent this year because all the Christmas parties will be canceled. I thought that was rather a different way of looking at what most people consider to be a downer. This is usually the season to make merry, right? And I know traditional Adventists are always, this is a season like Lent, but it really isn't a season like Lent. It's a season to make merry. Even among Christians, it's always been, that's why the Advent calendar exists. That's why Christmas trees exist. That's why people have their parties and their family time. But we, one good old-fashioned pastor up there saying, great, no parties. And I thought, no, you're really out of step. We need, everybody needs some parties in this country and this world right now. They're going to be Zoom Christmas parties, I guess. It really is going to be the oddest Christmas. For those of us who aren't really in love with the whole idea of going off to the Christmas party, it's not so bad. But for the rest of us, you can all make donations, right? Instead, go to your office and say, hey, we're not going to have a Christmas party. Why don't we give all the money we would have spent on booze and bad pastry and give it to Angel Tree? Run over today and over at HughHewitt.com. Let's just have the office make an Angel Tree donation, would you? Your gift will go help kids who do not have a mom or dad at home this Christmas because they're in jail, in prison, serving 25 to life or 5 years or 3 years or whatever, but they're not home, and Angel Tree takes care of them through the year, but they provide Christmas. Your gift will help someone like Kevin, who was only five when his mom was incarcerated at Rikers Island in New York. But he says all these years, his most precious Christmas memories came from Angel Tree volunteers.
It was cool to know that in some form of a way, she was still like looking out for me, even though she wasn't there. I had hope and could definitely still feel that love and that bond between us. I think it's so important to support Angel Tree. You have no idea the hope that you're instilling in them just by that simple gesture of them receiving a gift from the parent, even though the parent is not there.
That's why Angel Tree, don't do a Christmas party, just support Angel Tree. Go to HughHewitt.com and hit that banner at the very top. You'll be joining thousands of people who've already signed up. Thank you. I'm impressed by how many of my listeners want to help, and God bless you all. Look, the biggest story of the day is that the virus is raging through the country, but the vaccine is coursing through it as well. It's not legal yet to give it to anybody. That should come this week, but it is being pre-positioned and flown everywhere from both Moderna and Pfizer. And Anthony Fauci was on this week with Martha Raddatz. He was on Meet the Press yesterday, gave the same message everywhere. It's a bad month in terms of infections. Lots of people are going to get it who aren't being cautious. But it's a good month, he said on Meet the Press. Pretty much most of all frontline workers will have the vaccine by the end of December. My research toxicologist, the official research toxicologist of the Hugh Hewitt Show, retired PhD, said all medical workers will have it by the end of December. He's hopeful everyone who wants it will have it by the end of March. He'll take either Moderna or Pfizer. He's glad that we're going to have the choice of the mRNA vaccines as opposed to the AstraZeneca vaccine, but the AstraZeneca vaccine will be useful in the third world where they don't have the refrigeration. More on that coming up. But here's just one clip of Anthony Fauci on Meet the Press yesterday with Martha Raddatz, cuts number three.
Well, you know, Martha, that's a good question. We get asked it all the time. You know, we say it not being facetiously as a soundbite or anything, but, you know, close the bars and keep the schools open is what we really say. Obviously, you don't have one size fits all, but as I said in the past, and as you accurately quoted me, the default position should be to try as best as possible within reason to keep the children in school or to get them back to school. The best way to ensure the safety of the children in school is to get the community level of spread low. So if you mitigate the things that you know are causing spread in a very, very profound way, in a robust way, if you bring that down, you will then indirectly and ultimately protect the children in the school, because the community level is determined how things go across the board. So my feeling would be the same thing. If you look at the data, the spread among children and from children is not really very big at all, not like one would have suspected. So let's try to get the kids back, but let's try to mitigate the things that maintain and just push the kind of community spread that we're trying to avoid. And those are the things.
I am not an epidemiologist, nor did I stay at a Holiday Inn last night. I'm not a virologist, and I didn't stay at a Holiday Inn last night. But from the fact that I was the first guy to sound the alarm on the virus in January to the fact that in February I said close everything but the schools, I've always said keep the schools open. Doesn't hit the kids. Does not affect the kids. They can transmit it, but you still got to get, you know, go to the younger teachers, keep the fragile teachers at home, but keep the kids in school because the impact on them is terrible. Everyone's kind of got that message. It's not, and Dr. Fauci was wrong about that at the beginning, but he's right about it now. And it's okay to have been wrong when we didn't know anything about anything, and it's right now to be right. So just lay on your school board. You know, they ought to really not have an extended Christmas holiday. They ought to be making up for lost time. I was on Meet the Press yesterday. Here's cut number one. Chuck asked me about whether or not I'm using the radio program to make sure that no one is suffering under the delusion that President Trump won and President-elect Biden didn't. Cut number one.
Hugh Hewitt, your listeners, they don't, maybe they don't want to believe the facts that are on the ground. Do you feel like you confront your listeners enough that don't want to believe the facts, or do you think you could do more?
Oh, every day I talk to people who believe that there's massive fraud in Georgia, and I tell them no, and they've got to get out and vote for David Perdue and Kelly Loeffler, who I support. But I think what's going on is an undervaluation of the voters' intelligence again. They're very sophisticated. They know President Trump is, as of today, planning on running for election in 2024 against President-elect Biden, and he's doing things consistent with that. And I think he is going to spend the next 4 years underscoring the big successes of his tenure, including Operation Warp Speed. It was great news what Dr. Fauci said, that most of the frontline people will be vaccinated by the end of December. He's going to emphasize his military rebuild, the Supreme Court. He's going to emphasize conservative realism versus the Chinese Communist Party and the Abraham Accords. So he's just setting up a campaign that's already begun. And I wouldn't be surprised, Chuck, if on or before the inauguration of President Biden, he announces Trump 2024 is formed and it's off to the races.
I would look, he announced his reelection campaign on Inauguration Day in 2017.
That is my first cut. My second cut comes a little bit later in the show when we're talking about a different subject, cut number two.
Hugh Hewitt, I feel like that there's going to be some sort of, I don't know if it's a reckoning or what do you want to call it, on the right, where you're going to have some who say, hey, there's plenty of African Americans that would like to support conservatives or Republicans, but the branding, thanks to Donald Trump, makes it very hard to have that conversation. Do you think that changes in a post-Trump world?
I think it's already changing. Professor Dyson noted in the first panel segment that Donald Trump increased his numbers with African Americans significantly. And when you look at the biggest winners on Tuesday night a month ago were Kevin McCarthy in the House and Mitch McConnell in the Senate. And they're going to look at 16 Republican women who got elected. They're going to look at two African-American congressmen. They're going to look at, you know, Michelle Steele in Orange County, Young Kim in Orange County, California. They're going to want to diversify the party. And I haven't read the professor's new book. I've read Tears We Cannot Stop, his other book. And I would recommend McCarthy and McConnell and every Republican read that. And that Donald Trump, as he prepares for 2024, build on that 50% gain that he made by putting his arm around Tim Scott and other people who speak for African-American Republicans and Latino Republicans and say, what worked, what didn't, let's build on the former.
That is the extent of what I said on Meet the Press yesterday, but I'm glad I had a chance to say it. When we come back, Donald Trump was on Fox News with Maria Bartiromo. He said a lot more. We'll play what the president had to say.